So welcome everyone. Hi Namali.
Hi Lee, nice to see you today.
Likewise, how are you doing?
I'm good. Nice to see you in a very, very light and subtle version of turquoise.
It was the only thing I had that looked remotely like turquoise.
Well, it's getting cold here today. I mean, turquoise is a summer color. It mostly shows up in sort of summery stuff. So I've already put away all my summer clothes, and I did have a turquoise scarf though. So
nice.
So welcome to Exploring Turquoise. So I guess just like in every other call that we have done for all the other stages, I'd like to begin by just saying that a lot of this information comes from Lee, you and I both having been in this developmental psychology, developmental adult education arena for quite a while, using it in our work as coaches, as facilitators. We have been in the integral world for a long time. By that, what we mean is we've probably read a lot of work by developmentalists, such as Robert Keegan, Suzanne Kukreuter, Jane Lovinger, many others, Piaget, lots of other people who speak about these sense of developmental stages. Of course, Clare Graves, Don Beck, Christopher Cowan, the spiral dynamics world, and Ken Wilber's work. So I guess it's also important as we begin to speak about these higher stages. We spoke about yellow in our previous call, teal in Ken Wilber's world, and today we speak about turquoise. These are all really late stage or very nascent new ways of the structures. And so much of what we're saying, and even as the teachers of these theories would say themselves, what we know about these late stages, what we call second tier and beyond, can be somewhat speculative and tentative just because there aren't that many members of the society that can be researched. So, and that's okay. We're still drawing from a large body of work, and I think the teachers have been careful about that. And I want to remind everyone who becomes aware of developmental stage studies to be careful in the ways that we use and apply these teachings in our day-to-day work with clients or in how we lead or however, because we can get into trouble, especially those of us who are perhaps at least on a good day imagining that there's some of these late stages in us. So I think it behooves upon us to be even more careful. So the other thing that I also want to say, as we get into these stage studies, especially when it comes to these later stages, even as per Suzanne Kukreuter's teachings, she herself has said that most of this research really comes or has been done in mostly Western societies, mostly only Western societies, mostly only Western educated communities, mostly white communities, and mostly English native speakers for whom English is a native language, or English speakers for whom it's a fluent second language. So I think these things are all important to keep in mind. I just sort of want to say that just for my own sense of integrity. So part of me speaks about these higher stages with some trepidation, some sort of additional care, and a healthy dose of, you know, speculation, as well as a healthy dose of curiosity and open-mindedness. Even green communities and teal yellow communities are still very tiny, let alone turquoise and beyond. So anywho, but let me say a little bit about how perhaps teal yellow began to experience its own drawbacks that perhaps then leads teal into turquoise. Some of the biggest known blind spots of teal in Wilber, yellow in spiral dynamics, is perhaps that sense of being led to a kind of a disillusion, just like in any other stage, where there's a sort of a disintegration towards the latter parts of development within that stage. Yellow is really good at learning. They learn a lot and they try to apply that in the things that they do. There's an excitement about the new freedom or liberation that they actually gain from having departed from the postmodern green stage. But all their learning is still, or there's a realization that for yellow, their learning is still quite heady and quite intellectual. And so it can begin to feel a bit clunky. And I think internally, when they really tap into authenticity, which is really important for teal, within that authenticity, I think yellow begins to realize that I'm not quite in flow with the teachings that I've come to know of. I'm not quite embodying them yet. And that realization can lead to some disillusionment that there's more, there's more to go. The good thing is with these late stages is there's actually, hopefully, an anticipation and excitement that, wow, I don't know it all and I'm not all of it by any means. There's more to come. So this is what is, I think, perhaps, you know, like we said earlier in the spiral, it's in these second tier stages that one becomes aware of our history and our journey through the spiral. So that gives us a kind of a liberation that, wow, we can anticipate. I've often mentioned this. I like what Don Beck says around transcend, include, and anticipate. So hopefully at yellow, teal, there's a healthy dose of anticipation that comes with this disillusionment that even the sort of the early stages of second tier is still very early, to kind of put it lightly. So they're so plugged into, yellow is so plugged into map making and analyzing and categorizing and color coding and all of that, that it helps them make sense and sort of make meaning of the like the deep doo-doo, which is my technical term for the crisis in the world. Yellow realizes that there's a potentially different way of being in the world and meaning making. Maps don't explain it all. These integral maps, spiral dynamics, all of these things, they're pointing towards a territory that we haven't really embodied yet or really immersed ourselves in it. Certainly not enough for it to be a trait beyond a state. So yellow is hurting from the carpet burn they received from the pathologies of postmodernism, green, all the communities that they wanted to be a part of, or the sensitivity that they were practicing, and the political correctness and activism, fighting for causes. And so I think yellow came in with an exhaustion from that. And so the liberation for yellow was to become individual again, to practice agency again. And that's another thing that I think as we are perhaps ready to depart from yellow, that agency is also a hyper agency that is pathological in our being. So maybe there is a deeper yearning, a deeper longing to commune again, to be in communion again, to be more merged and collaborating. So that's another kind of a dissatisfaction that is perhaps leading us out of that hyper agentic, highly intellectual map making way of sense making in the world. And I remember a story that my Integral Coaching Canada teachers used to tell us. I was in a cohort in my coaching program where all of the students already knew integral theory. And so we all came with the understanding of these philosophies and sort of in general, how to apply them in our lives. And I remember our teachers telling us, this is the first time we've had a group of students, an entire cohort that is, generally speaking, on a good day, perhaps integral or yellow. And we weren't a very united cohort. We were very focused on doing well. We were very focused on learning. but they used to call us like racehorses. That racehorses, you know, they're very focused and they just run and they don't look to the sides. And this was, I still remember that struck a chord for our cohort. It's like at yellow, you're so dedicated and committed to growth, and you realize that there is this sense of vertical development and also horizontal development. But in that commitment and in our comfort and liberation of being individual, we've lost that sense of collaboration, unity. And so there is now a need to merge again. Oddly enough, it's starting to look a little bit like what yellow resisted, having departed from green. It almost looks like we want to go back to green, except I think we are looking at turquoise, which is resembling green a lot, just because it's becoming much more holistic at turquoise. And turquoise is, in a strange way, able to deconstruct again. It's not necessarily the postmodern deconstruction, but as Suzanne Kogreuter says, this turquoise stage is construct aware. And by that, what she means is that at green, postmodernists deconstructed everything. There is no truth. Everything is relative. There is no meaning. There is no good or bad. And that's a very powerful insight in and of itself for postmodernism. And at yellow, teal, and at early integral, we begin to see that no, it's everything is relative, and yet we can transcend while including that view to seeing that there's also some absolutes. There are certain things that are good and bad. There are some things that are gooder, as Ken Wilber used to say. Everything is not equal. And so that's yet another complex higher perspective that teal brings. And then as they see those multiple perspectives, turquoise sees that even those multiple perspectives that even a high stage as yellow was capable of seeing is actually human made, or it's constructed by our mind and language that we find ourselves using. So turquoise begins to see that we can construct, we can deconstruct, we can co-construct, we can reconstruct. There is a once again a higher level of liberation that comes for oneself, because you really see that so much of this is our ego creating the world. We take for granted that even simple things like space and time, or even just really tangible things like tables and chairs, these are all to some degree human-made, human-constructed, mind-constructed concepts. And no two people necessarily would agree on what a chair is or what a bed might be. So anything that comes into awareness is constructed. Therefore, turquoise is called construct aware. And at this point, at turquoise, we do begin to grasp some higher spiritual teachings, spiritual realities, because that sense of self is now beginning to dissolve more than any of the stages were able to see that dissolution dissolving. Turquoise is really beginning to show signs of being a spiral wizard. They really begin to see that this vertical development, as healthy and as wonderful as that may seem, it's not even that might be a construct. Even that might be a construct. And how can we drop even that? Or at the very least, just play with the ideas of how all of this is a construct. I, my sense of self, is a construct. How do I let go of it all? Just to close just that, my little bit of opening into kind of this introduction to turquoise is is turquoise in both spiral dynamics as well as Ken Wilber's integral theory. Turquoise is a return to a cool color. So turquoise is more collective. It's a little bit of a swing back to the right brain. And you could also say a little bit more of a sort of a feminine principle. It's a self-sacrificing stage again. And it's sort of like the beginning of the bodhisattva vow, in the sense of that turquoise is able to see that sense of sacrificing oneself for a higher enlightenment. And this idea that I can delay my enlightenment until more people are liberated. So, yeah, so let me just pause at that.
Well, great introduction, Amalia. And indeed, as you say, that at Yellow, there's a sense of the historical development that we've experienced as an individual, but also as a society, as humanity, that we can look back at the evolutionary process and see it as an unfolding expression of a mystery, basically, over time. And at Turquoise, indeed, we begin to feel into what it's like to be an embodiment of that mystery.
In Turquoise, a lot of these spiritual practices, spiritual views are really beginning to show up much more fully than some of the previous stages, in a much more, you're in flow with it more, it's more embodied. If we are diligent, if we practice more, we can aim towards how these spiritual realities would become more trait-like, more of a stable reality.
Yes, I think that's a good point. And I would say that it's wise that you're reluctant to speak about these higher stages because of the lack of large amounts of data about these stages and about how people function at these higher levels of development or value memes. And at the same time, I would say that it's also useful to plot out speculatively, as you say, the outlines of these higher levels of development, because many of us have these state experiences and notice that when we practice with these states, we can turn them over time into more trait-like characteristics. And so it's good to be able to have a sort of a roadmap to see where are we moving, and also so that we can feel confident that our experiences, even though they're very atypical in some cases, that they still belong within the spectrum of human experiences.
You know, I also want to say, because of, you know, with the carefulness with which we're both entering the discussion around higher stages, is to some degree something we've done with the other stages where we have talked about the dignity and the disaster of each stage. I think that when we know so little about some of these higher stages, I don't think it's useful so much to try and find a disaster of teal yellow or a disaster of turquoise. But I don't know that we know enough what's good, what's not so great, perhaps.
Well, that's fine. Although I think we can say, conceptually, we can say that most of the dignities are the healthy expressions of the stage of development, and that the disasters are typically either the rejection of previous stages of development or the addiction to higher stages of development. And from that, we can sort of draw some conclusions. And I think you and I both in ourselves have experienced at times shadow sides of spiritual development, and that we've also seen that in other people who come together in communities, and that there are some specific maladies that occur when you get a group of people together who are geared towards collective spiritual and personal development. And I think some of those things can be said to be an approximation of the disasters of, for instance, sure, yellow and turquoise.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there are many that are visible and tangible enough that we can talk about. And I think just to add to some of the pathologies that you've already just now mentioned, I think the one of the biggest pathologies of these higher stages is mistaking the teachings to be the territory, or that just because we know these things, to talk about them or to read and to write about these higher stages does not mean that we're actually inhabiting and embodying those values. As humanity grows more deeper into these higher stages, there's also a greater need to explore trauma and such as well. Some words that are often thrown around when we talk about turquoise are words like holistic, harmonizing, interbeing, interdependent, synergizing, synthesizing, accepting and welcoming of paradoxes and polarities, sustainability of the entire spiral, planetary systems, energy systems, in other words, sort of more also like transpersonal. When we speak about transpersonal, these post-conventional transpersonal realms are sources of learning for turquoise, and there's an openness to that. I think lifestyles can be quite minimalistic, because I think there is a greater empathy towards what we have done to the planet. I think another energy of turquoise is that there is a deeper embrace of all of sentience, feelings, sensitivity. So again, notice how even as I say these things, they sound like green. They sound like some of those sensitivities and empathy related topics we talked about in green. But there is a greater heartbreak, an even greater heartbreak for humanity at turquoise. And there is a more heart-centered yearning to want to do what one can to help the ways in which humanity or the planet is broken. Turquoise is much more able to let go of these things like spiral dynamics and integral maps, and there's a humbling in the face of becoming ego aware that all of this is a construct.
I was actually thinking back to the disasters, and one of the things we haven't mentioned yet was also the phenomenon of spiritual bypassing, and which is a very interesting phenomenon where we focus so profoundly on spiritual development and on interpreting things in a spiritual way that we can lose touch with the more mundane aspects of reality to our detriment. And that can be a sort of a shutting off of the lower, so to speak, vital aspects of ourselves, and focusing on trying to be at a higher stage of development than we are. So I would say that spiritual bypassing is also related to a deep desire to want to be further than we are along the developmental path. And also we become more purpose driven at turquoise in a way that is indeed in service of the whole. And the whole is then typically interpreted as the whole earth or the whole of humanity or the whole realm spiral. Of sentient, the whole spiral indeed, or the whole realm of sentient beings that we know of. And I think that's a very beautiful thing. So that's one of the dignities of turquoise, is that because of that willingness to be of service, we can do a lot of good in our lives. And of course, one of the challenges is that to then connect with other people who have different perspectives and work together in a way that is constructive and effective. And that's one of the things, for instance, that at green is very difficult, but that at turquoise becomes much easier because we're able to connect beyond ideologies and beyond limiting beliefs. And so, for instance, we've often spoken about differences politically between left and right and how they potentially can be plotted across the spiral. And at these yellow and turquoise levels of development, we can see that things are not so monolithic, and that we can have different areas in life in which we have different ideas politically about what the best solutions are for those issues, for instance. So it becomes much easier to collaborate across political divides and across ideological divides at turquoise. because we're not so attached to our own perspectives at that level as we were throughout the first tier levels. And because, as we said, this is a level of increasing ego awareness, we can see that the beliefs we held throughout our life have perhaps changed, our opinions, some of them have changed, some of course have remained the same, but we can see that it's a living system basically of different perspectives, different memes, different ideologies. And once we're able to see that as an object in our awareness, we can see that we're alike in that respect with to all other human beings. So we all have these constructs, and with other people who are also able to see their own constructs in their awareness, we can then connect at a deeper level and navigate those differences in ideologies or beliefs very skillfully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I think turquoise, more than yellow, turquoise really has a recognition, is capable of recognizing that the world's wicked problems cannot be solved, you know, in isolation through some individual genius, that the answers to the big problems in fact must to some degree include and embrace the whole spiral, the wisdom that can come from the entire spiral, and empathy for the pathologies of the entire spiral. There is hopefully a commitment to consult the entire spiral if you are a turquoise leader, for example. In an interesting sense, turquoise, as it is more complex, it is also recognizing the value of simplicity and simplifying. So I think in a way, that's why there is a greater friendliness towards seeking empathy and wanting to offer empathy, and the sort of the intangible is just as deeply valued as the tangible. So I think it is a bit of a defining characteristic at turquoise that you're really yearning to simplify so that you can reach a far greater span of humanity to be of service. There is a far greater need to hold space for polarities and differences, and even see these polarities as sacred even. So I also want to say that in spiral dynamics, we've talked about how there's this resemblance, like that all cool colors, for example, resemble each other. Sometimes they have these qualities that are similar, dignities that are somewhat similar, and pathologies that are somewhat similar. So in that sense, we can also see that turquoise perhaps resembles purple, amber, blue, and green. So some of its gifts come from being collective. And I think the underbelly of that can also spell doom for these stages. In the same way that it reverses itself into the other more self-expressing individual stages that are the warm colors. Turquoise is actually seeking all order, and you said purpose. It's seeking order out of chaos in the same way that blue amber was trying to bring order out of the chaos of red. Perhaps it's really seeking sensitivity and diversity and a more embrace of humanity and the entire cosmos in the way that the green was trying to do that. And also magical, there's an enchantment, there's a return to enchantment, simplicity in the way that purple was perhaps embodying. So that's also a sort of a fun way of exploring what purple might look and feel like. I'm sorry, that turquoise might look and feel like.
Also interesting to note is that at turquoise, that's the first communal color where hierarchy makes its re-entry after green, because of course for green, hierarchy is very thorny. And at turquoise, there's a recognition of the orange principle that some things are better than others within particular contexts. And what turquoise is then able to do as a communal color is to say, if we're working together, okay, you do what you're best at, I'll do what I'm best at, and we'll find people who are good at the things we're not good at to collaborate in the most effective way possible. And there's a sort of a recognition that within a particular context, the person who has the best talents, abilities, skills, or aims is the best person to take leadership within that context as a temporary role, basically. So it's very flexible and outcome oriented, but with a recognition of the usefulness of natural and performance hierarchies.
Yeah, and I think what you say reminds me of also how I think Suzanne Kogreda wrote about this, where there's a lot of consultants and coaches and, you know, these kind of mentors and guides at Yellow, because there is such a new realization about this sense of vertical development, and that there is an indication that we can be better. And so there's a heavy emphasis on becoming better, 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 which is, again, it's very much like the orange. We can do better, we can do more. And turquoise is actually able to see, yes, there is better, but also because of its deeper empathy for the whole spiral, it's also able to bring a lot more, let's just see the world for what it is and relax into that. There doesn't need to be this bettering and kind of this endless need for advancement. So that is also just a beauty, a beautiful aspect of turquoise. And it's a good thing for those of us who are coaches and consultants and facilitators to remember.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good point, Namali. And I would say that the process of becoming ego aware is the process by which we see that ongoing personal development is tinkering around the self, and that we then want to, of course, we want to have an optimally functional self, but at the same time, we don't want all of our attention to go into the self, because we also want to transcend the self so that we can align our individual self with the largest self that we can resonate with. And that becomes larger and larger the higher up the later stages we go, until at the ostensibly highest stage of development that we know of at this point in human history, we can experience our small self, our individual self, as an expression of basically everything that exists. So of as a single indivisible reality of which we're all an expression.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think this sort of this ego awareness, this sort of more, a little bit more of a relaxed attitude of turquoise, another dignity of turquoise is also perhaps that they're actually able to relax and be more playful, not so rigid about the hierarchies. Although they're hierarchy and holarchy aware, they're also less rigid about all of that. There's just a little bit more of not having to be so clunky and boxy about these teachings in the way that first year yellow was. Turquoise is able to be more fluid and sort of pour themselves into the nooks and crannies of the world. Yeah, there's a sort of a more liquid like movement and fluidity in the turquoise spiral wizard. I also want to just mention, because we talked about the resemblance of the cool colors, and there's obviously the resemblance of the warm colors, the contrast between green and turquoise, and for yellow in the middle, there is this Achilles heel of the pre-trans fallacy that even yellow can make, where it might block its own growth and evolution of seeing some the qualities of turquoise and dismissing them as green. And so in oneself as well as in others. So yellow could really fall into that trap of seeing a turquoise leadership quality, for example, and somehow dismissing it and negating that as, oh, that's just too green. So you have to really pay attention. Green was able to embrace polarities and paradoxes, and it was all about community. But green, as we now know, was really about people who thought like themselves. So green really was all about community, but more about communities that thought in the same way. I'm not saying that very well today for some reason, but turquoise, in contrast to that, is really capable of, even though they may not fully embrace that and fully be able to embody that, turquoise is much far greater seeing that the whole spiral with all of its diverse perspectives, with all of its brokenness and glory, that it's all valuable and necessary. So everybody does belong, and everything does belong to turquoise. At least conceptually, they really do see that, and they will embody that better than any of the other stages have thus far. So Lee, maybe let's maybe just specifically note some pathologies or some sort of, you know, slight little bumps on the road for turquoise. Although we've already talked a little bit about it, but more specifically, perhaps.
So within some spiritual communities, there can be the notion that some emotions, for instance, or some thoughts are undesirable. So for instance, there's of course a Buddhist perspective that anger is undesirable, and that can lead to people then behaving in a way that is somewhat inauthentic, where they try to avoid expressing anger even if they're feeling angry, so then people can communicate in a way that tries to be harmonious but has passive aggressive undertones. So that's one way in which we can see that as we get to higher levels of development, the pathologies are typically much more subtle and much more difficult to spot, and at the same time can be very undermining and very destructive. So that would be an example. And we mentioned earlier, of course, the spiritual bypassing, where we feel that we're somewhat detached from the world in a certain sense, that our spiritual life is more important than our worldly life, our sacred life is more important than our profane life, so to speak. And we can get into difficulties where we pay too little attention to relationships or to our partners, to our work, to things that are very essential to living a normal human life. So there can be this sense that spiritual development should be accompanied by a sense of asceticism or detachment, and that can cause disruption in our life if we go too far down that path.
Right. It reminds me of the Buddha who, when he was seeking his spiritual enlightenment, prior to finding the middle path, which is one of the principal teachings of Buddhism, he gave up everything and he lived the life of the renunciate. And he realized that this is not the way to really be an enlightened leader or an enlightened person. So he had to give up that false sense of I must renunciate everything, I must let go of everything, you know, and live like a beggar and a pauper and give up all my, you know, certainly give up luxuries and, you know, but I think what you're talking reminds me of that, and that turquoise is perhaps so much in this spiritual realm to some degree that they'll overdo that in some ways to the detriment of real development and authentic development. So in other words, what I would add to that is turquoise at some point, yes, you can commit to that higher realms and the transpersonal realms, but then you need to stay in touch with the marketplace, is how I would say it. And the marketplace includes dealing with your own trauma, dealing with a greater degree of shadow that you have, even more than yellow, because there's now the whole spiral inside of you, and an even greater degree of humility is required, because at Turquoise, hopefully one isn't forgetting that there's yet further development to come. Coral and indigo and all of that. So, and I wanted to really read this. I was sort of sneaking into my notes a little bit as you were talking there, Lee. This is written by Suzanne Kogreuter in a very old paper that she wrote. And I think you're going to laugh hearing this, because you'll know why. So she's talking about the magician. Suzanne Kogreuter gives the word, the stage turquoise, the magician, the downfall, sort of the beginning of the downfall. We're naturally reluctant to relinquish our familiar mode of functioning. We do not want to give up the illusion of our enduring separate identity, which we so laboriously learned to define, cultivate, and rely on for most of our conscious lives. Even if we understand that letting go of our attachment to the known will bring freedom from familiar kinds of suffering, this is something we know at Turquoise, attempts at doing so are mostly ineffective and always lead to intractable paradoxes. The more one becomes attached to the idea of non-attachment, something that we're trying to do at Turquoise, the more firmly one remains fettered. The more one is conscious and proud of one's psychic powers and ego-transcending quest, the more clearly one's ego is still enthroned. Trungpa Rinpoche, in 1987, his book Cutting Through Spiritual Materialism, and has perhaps given one of the most cogent analyses of how the ego can usurp transpersonal episodes for its own glorification. It is a fact of the magician life, meaning the turquoise life, the turquoise stage, that there are few people like them. They may fear that almost nobody understands them in their complexity and sympathizes with their experience. And fearing this, they feel culpable of hubris, of feeling better than others. They also observe in their own self-attachment and their need for a permanent self-identity by even bigger self-theories. On the other hand, they truly appreciate others' need to make sense of their lives within their own means. They therefore have a much deeper tolerance for others' solutions to life's conditions without being blind to the possible shortcomings and limitations of such solutions. Sometimes magicians express a sense of envy at the simplicity of earlier periods because their own world is experienced as so complex. However, given their ego maturity, most are capable of arriving at a dynamic and hopeful balance within these fundamental conflicts. They fulfill their perceived or chosen destiny independently and courageously in full realization of their basic despair and aloneness. When they cannot integrate this awareness, their depression is about man's essential aloneness and inability to create lasting meaning through the rational enterprise. Speaking about sort of feeling like they're so complex and nobody understands them, and there's this aloneness and they're too, in a way, too special. This all sounded a little bit familiar to me from the Enneagram 4 perspective. So anyway, all that was a bit much, a little bit to read, but I think it is very indicative of the sort of the underbelly of the turquoise meme, their own complexity and their own brilliance in some ways is their own shadow. This sort of false humility and false hubris that I think you talked about earlier as well. Let's talk a little bit about, what can we actually practically do, bring into our lives? You and I, we call ourselves practicalintegral.com for a reason, because we are trying to see how we can be practical about these teachings in our lives. So I would say one of the most beautiful turquoise-like practices that we can do is learning when we observe something in ourselves or in the ways that we know ourselves, or the way that I know you or someone else, or something else, is to try and unname and unlabel it, so that you can investigate really into what is it without the labeling and the judgments and the opinions that I have given that object or that being. So, who is Nomali if Nomali gets out of the way? If I'm not Nomali, I've given so much identity to who is Nomali or who is Lee. And if I can look at you and see you as not Lee, then who are you? I get to see you in a whole new way. That's not easy to do. That's why turquoise has this level of complexity. So to unname things that we think we know and understand, make it empty and devoid of the judgments, the opinions, and interpretations that we give ourselves, others, and things. And that's a very, very spiritual practice. It's something that we learn in meditation, is to simply see something for what it is, beyond the interpretation that we've given it. So that's just one practice that comes to my mind.
That's very beautiful, Nomali. And within the work of Suzanne Cook-Reuter, among others, she describes these developmental stages as increases in perspectives. And we can say that at the yellow level of development or teal, we're able to shift perspectives from one to another and do that very skillfully. And indeed, at the turquoise level of development, we become able to then look upon all of the perspectives without actually inhabiting them too deeply. So your practice is actually pointing directly to that, is to look beyond perspective. So to look with a beginner's mind, as Zen would say, indeed, to look at the reality as indivisible and just as presenting itself to us. So that's a beautiful practice. And I would also add the things like pattern recognition. So to be aware of systems and how things relate beyond the obvious interrelation. So to see, as you said during the previous video, you said codependent origination, or what was that?
Codependent origination. Yeah, that's a
Yes.
Buddhist concept. Yeah.
Yes, so that everything arises together and is interrelated and exists in relation to each other. So to see the whole fabric of reality in that way, and to see the patterns that manifest themselves, that's actually the step to the next higher level, to coral indigo. Because as Ken Wilber speaks about those higher stages, he speaks about turquoise as thinking whole, and he speaks about coral indigo as a seeing whole. And then afterwards, we go to feeling whole and to witnessing whole and to being whole at the clear light, highest known stage at this point. So that's a very beautiful practice that you alluded to, which is indeed completely in keeping with the theoretical constructs that we've been speaking about.
Yeah. Another practice that comes to my mind is just simply, I think, invest a little more time and energy in a spiritual practice. Just really dedicate some commitment to that. I would also say, genuinely seek out collaboration, genuinely go out into the world, go out into the marketplace. Really hard to do for integralists, honestly, to sort of go into communities that may not understand you, may not get where you're coming from, and to let go of the need to be understood and seen and known and all of that. You need that, and you want to find the like-minded communities, but also make an effort to go where you feel that perhaps you've left behind and that you have no need for that anymore. And in speaking of that, I think if you find yourself overly bothered by for integrals, especially if you find yourself overly bothered by first year stages, especially green, you're probably stuck in the shadow of yellow. So in order to explore turquoise more, really learn about these kinds of shadow elements of yellow, which could help loosen that grip.
There's also a practice called Theory U, developed by Otto Sharma. And mm-hmm. it's a translation of what you were saying earlier, where you basically start at the typical level of daily interaction, and then you go a level deeper where you sort of listen with an open mind, and then you listen with an open heart. And then at the bottom of the U that you go through, you listen with what he calls an open will. And that's basically being receptive to whatever wants to emerge. And the term he uses is presencing. You're basically in the present, sensing what wants to emerge in that moment. And that's a way in which we can also relate to other people indeed. And a technique that is also used in organizations and teams to promote collaboration.
Right. And when you speak of Otto Sharma's work, I'm reminded of Barry Johnson's work of polarity management, polarity perspectives, and, you know, talk about not falsely believing that a certain pole is the only correct pole, that a pole is always a polarity to another perspective. And so to really try and honor both sides of a polarity is just deeply beautiful work that comes from Barry Johnson. I would say explore that as a practice to explore more of the turquoise realm. I think also remember turquoise is around, in a way, simplifying. So a little bit more right brain activities, such as just expressing your creativity through art and music and writing and just, yeah, the things that put you into the flow state, challenging yourself, but also doing things that bring you joy. Humor, like learning to relax and being playful. I've heard, I don't know if it's Suzanne or who, but the turquoise can also be called the joker stage. So just to take life a little bit more with a grain of salt, because after all, who are we? That we are becoming more, to really explore that realm of the ego and how that is a construction. I also think another really great practice is to consciously choose something that is complex and try to simplify that. Try to see how you can perhaps make it practical, simple, and yet not water it down. You can still hold on to the depth of the teaching or whatever it is that is complex, but make it more accessible to a larger body of the society. Or, you know, I think that's a really cool practice as well, to take something that is really complex and sophisticated and then see how you can simplify that.
Yeah. I would also say to engage, for instance, in voluntary work or things that contribute to the well-being of others or to ecosystems or to the continued survival of the human species or animal species, things like that, to be of service in a way that is purposeful and within a larger context related to our living environment on the planet.
Yeah, and I think you can do that almost in a sort of a Marie Kondo kind of way, in which Marie Kondo, you know, take things and then ask it, does this spark joy in you? I think from a turquoise perspective, I think you can just look around your world, your life, and you can actually let go of things that don't serve you or the planet as a whole. In a sense, you can ask, does this actually serve? And whether it's a habit or whether it's an object. Yeah, just learning to sort of let go of things by investigating how does holding on to this serve or not serve, and undertaking practices like volunteering, as you said, that really do serve in a way. It's sort of like opening up your life more to have time for things like volunteering or serving the planet by eliminating a lot of distractions that really don't serve us anymore. And I think I might also just say, you know, finding ways to do even practices like Tonglen practice, where you actually just get to really practice compassion and really feel the hurt and the brokenness of the world. And then to come out of it with discernment, not sort of just kind of becoming a puddle, but to come out of it with discernment and clear ideas and thoughts around how do I now want to serve. I would also say just kind of learning about things like, you know, we spoke about Otto Scharmer, Barry Johnson, obviously teachers like Ken Wilber, and, you know, a lot of these teachers are amazing. Sasanko Greuter, there's endless amounts of teachers that we should explore. And that also reminds me of Rupert Sheldrake and morphogenetic grooves and morphic fields. That those kinds of teachings are also valuable as we explore turquoise. So I look forward to seeing you in your coral shirt or indigo shirt. We will do our best to, I've had a lot of hesitation to even discuss these higher stages, but I shall show up with an open mind to speaking about things that I know nothing about. And and we will have another call and that call will be our last call in this series of stages. So I look forward to kind of exploring this, the highest stages that we can even begin to speculate about. I think it'll be fun to do that.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Right. Well, thanks everyone for watching, and thanks to Molly.
Thank you, Lee. Talk to you later.
See you soon. Bye. Okay.